Right. So let's discuss infinite dimensional manifolds in the Bastiani setting. And as I said, everything will now, from now on, if I say differentiable, will mean Bastiani differentiable. And what we want to do here is we want to define manifolds which may be modeled on infinite dimensional spaces. So again, the idea is we want to do it as simple as possible. And what a manifold should be is a topological space with an assortment of charts. And now the difference between the finite dimension and the infinite dimensional definition of a manifold will be that our charts are allowed to take values in locally convex spaces. And then we have to explain what differentiability of the change of charts should be. And this will be differentiability in the Bastiani setting. And the motto for this whole section is the right definitions from finite dimensional differential geometry carry over to the Bastiani setting. So we will observe in a later chapter what I mean by that. Just as a general philosophy, for all we are going to do in this lecture on infinite dimensional manifolds and also on differential geometry, we usually have to pick one of the definitions, say, for example, of a manifold from or tangent spaces or whatnot from finite dimensions. And it turns out there's usually one definition you want to pick because it turns out that it is the strongest one. What do I mean by that? So in finite dimensions, we'll see in a moment how you define tangent spaces in the infinite dimension setting. In finite dimensions, there are at least, I would say, two, three ways of defining a tangent space using different notions of what you mean by a tangent vector to a manifold. And in finite dimensions, all of these definitions are equivalent. Whereas in infinite dimensions, you can show that some of them are stronger than others. And there are even some which don't make sense in infinite dimensions. So that's what I mean by right definitions. One has to be sometimes a bit careful which definition you pick. Okay, and let's start with the definition of a manifold. And it should be no surprise. So we say a Hausdorff topological space, we call everything should be Hausdorff. M has an E chart around if there is an open subset of the M and a homeomorphism from this open subset, so U phi, onto an open subset of the model space, so this locally convex space E, and we call this an E chart. And CR atlas for our manifold M is then a set of charts such that the chart domains U phi cover all of our manifold. And this is the first property we have down there. So M should be covered. And since we were asking for a CR atlas, we want that the change of charts are CR. Okay, and the change of charts, as you might recall from the finite dimension setting, is just you compose phi with, say, psi inverse, for example, on the intersection of their domains. And you ask that these mappings are CR in the Bastiani setting. Okay, so let's just go to the writing again. So change of charts. If phi U phi and psi U psi are charts for M, we say that phi composed with psi inverse and psi composed with phi inverse are the change of charts of these two charts. And I'm a bit sloppy here. So, I mean, usually what I should have been writing is, so phi composed with psi inverse. This is, of course, So I need to restrict this mapping, or this makes sense on the following set with psi of u phi intersected with u psi. And this is an so this is an open subset of the modeling space. But I will usually suppress this level of detail, right? So whenever in this section we write a change of charts, so for example, like phi composed with psi or something like this, I will always assume that we have restricted it to the correct open subset. And right, so so we are suppressing this, and let us note the following, that in the definition of an atlas, we do not require that all charts are homeomorphism into the same locally convex space. So in finite dimensions, one often defines a manifold of dimension n, say, for example, is one where all of the charts are homeomorphisms onto open subsets of Rn. In our case, we are not restricting ourselves here. So actually, some of the most interesting manifolds we will meet later on have charts which go into lots of different, even non-isomorphic, locally convex spaces. Of course, this is only possible because these manifolds we will be considering have lots of connected components. So if you have a C1 atlas, it is easy to see that on every connected component, the model space or the model spaces, so in case they're different ones, are isomorphic as locally convex spaces. The trick is basically if you have two charts, phi composed with psi inverse, so you're looking at the change of charts and they are defined on an open subset. So say E, this is defined on an open subset, I don't know, let's say call it O. This is going into another a priori different locally convex space. What you can prove is that then the derivative evaluated at one point, so this x is an O, this is a linear isomorphism. I shouldn't have written linear. So this is an isomorphism of locally convex spaces. However, there may be many more connected components, and there's no reason why the modeling space on these connected components should be the same. Okay. So, well, then after having defined an atlas, so I mean, all of these definitions should, apart from the weirdness possibly going on with the new calculus and that we have different model spaces, should be very familiar from finite dimensional differential geometry. And well, we say then that two CR atlases are equivalent if their union is again a CR atlas for M. This is also standard. And well, then the definition is if CR manifold is a Hausdorff topological space with an equivalence class of CR atlases. If we say modeled on E, this means there's just one modeling space for the whole atlas. Okay. In general, we won't consider such a thing, but it might happen depending on the thing. Okay. And another note, if you're familiar with finite dimensional manifolds, usually what people are requiring for finite dimensional manifolds is that they are either paracompact or second countable. And in general, the manifolds we will be considering will be neither paracompact nor second countable. So we don't ask for these. In a way, paracompactness and second countability are topological smallness conditions. And so we are not asking them in general. So this paracompactness and second countability will not play a role here. We will encounter it at some point later for finite dimension manifold, where it will be essential at, for something. But for our infinite dimension manifold, manifolds, we're not requiring that. Okay. And good. So we have this. So let's return now to see some examples. Okay. And the first example is well, the zeros example, if you want. 4, 5 example. Well, the easiest one you can think of, if U is an open subset E, then this becomes an infinite dimension manifold. Where the atlas is given by one chart. And the chart is just the inclusion mapping. So we have U included in E. And well, I mean, this is X is X. This is a homeomorphism onto this open set U sitting inside of E. I mean, this is really sort of the easiest example you can get of a manifold. So this basically shows open subsets of locally convex space, and locally convex spaces themselves are, again, infinite dimension manifolds. Next one should also be familiar. This is a so-called Hilbert sphere. This is much more special than the usual locally convex spaces we will be considering. So let us assume that H, an inner product, is a Hilbert space. Then we can define the so-called Hilbert sphere as H. Those are all the X in H, such that well, they have inner product or norm squared equal to 1. So this is a smooth manifold modeled on the Hilbert space H. And well, if you want to see how the charts look like, well, this is just, we pick a point in SH and then we define a chart on the Hilbert sphere. So U, X naught, and then all the X in SH, such that the inner product of X with X naught is larger than zero. And V of X naught, well, let's see, those are y in h such that two things are, so y of x naught should be zero, and y bracketed with the x, sorry, now I made a mistake here. Okay, let's, okay, so I need to recheck this, so let's so v, okay, let's first define the orthogonal complement hx naught. This is just all the x in h such that x bracketed with x naught is zero, or in other words, it's the orthogonal complement of the space generated by x naught. And right, so then we can define the vx naught as all the y in the orthogonal complement, such that what happened here? Ah, yes, sorry. I was confused with my own notes. Such that the bracket of y with itself is smaller than one. Okay. And what you can check is that you get a chart for the Hilbert sphere from ux naught taking values in all of ex naught. And what you do, you send x to x minus the product of x with x naught times x naught. So this is just the orthogonal projection from the Hilbert sphere onto this orthogonal complement of the x naught. And you can check, it's an exercise, this is a chart for SH around X naught, and the change of charts with respect to the atlas are smooth. Okay, right, so let's see. Now, okay, before we move on to something like tangent spaces or so forth, let's make a few more definitions which will come in handy later on. We also see more more examples of infinite dimension manifolds later. So let's assume that we have a CR manifold, infinite dimensional space modeled on a locally convex space E, so meaning that all of the charts are E charts, and F should be sequentially closed. Subspace. And now if you have attended the lecture this morning, you see already where this is going. So we want to define a submanifold of M modeled on F is a subset say S of this manifold M, such that for all X in S, there exists a chart phi, mu phi in this atlas A, such that x is in u phi, and if we just evaluate our chart on u phi intersected with the S, so in the subset we have, then we get B phi, the codomain of our chart, intersected with this sequentially closed vector space F. And the upshot of this, if this is true, then the phi S, so we define this as we restrict our phi to U phi intersected with S, and we co-restrict it to V phi restricted with F, is then an F chart for S. And due to lemma 1.2.12, this was what the lemma we did exactly before the break in the Bastiani chapter. This said a mapping is smooth, or a mapping which takes its values in a sequentially closed subspace is smooth if and only if it's smooth as a mapping into the subspace. So, okay, so this lemma says that the collection of all charts, of all F charts, phi S, where phi is coming from this this atlas we've been starting with, is CR atlas of S. Right, so the S really becomes a submanifold with respect to these charts, and usually we call the phi S the submanifold chart. Right, so the requirement is that on the subset, this chart really restricts to something which maps into the sequentially closed subspace. Okay, and an example for this we shall see later, that the Hilbert sphere is a submanifold of the ambient Hilbert space, if we consider the ambient Hilbert space as a manifold, right? And so note that there is a special situation for subspaces of locally convex spaces. Okay, let me just explain what I mean by this. So for finite dimensional spaces, so if we have if the dimension of the space is smaller than infinity, then all the locally convex spaces we can be looking at are basically of this kind. So we have Rn, and when we take out a subspace of Rn, to shove it a bit around, so Rd, so we can dissect Rn as Rd times Rn minus d. Okay, so we can always do this with an arbitrary subspace after identifying what's happening with the subspaces. Okay, and so this equality here we have is an equality of locally convex spaces. And if, let's assume now that the dimension of our space is infinite. So we have a locally convex space, which is infinite. And F is a subspace of the locally convex space E. So due to Zorn's lemma, or the axiom of choice, or whatever you prefer, we can always find a vector space complement. Such that the original space E is can be written or is isomorphic to F times the vector space complement. Let's call this vector. Perhaps it's not H. This looks like Hilbert space. Let's call the complement C. So this C here is another vector space, such we can write the given vector space E as F times C. However, in infinite dimensions, it turns out that the situation is more complicated than in finite dimensions. So in general, this isomorphism is just an isomorphism of vector spaces without topology. So there are infinite dimensional spaces, or there are subspaces of locally convex spaces, such that you can, of course, always, for abstract reasons, find a vector complement, but this complement might not be a topological complement. So what do I mean by this? So C is called topological complement if the mapping, so you add two things, F times C to E. So you take an F here and a C there, and you send it to F plus C. So you can always write down this mapping, and it will always make sense on the vector space side. So if this is homeomorphism right, so what this means is that the isomorphism upstairs you get here, which is in general only an isomorphism of abstract vector spaces, you want this isomorphism to be really an isomorphism of locally convex spaces. So it needs to respect the topology. And in general, you cannot, so there are well-known examples, we will see one later, where this cannot be done. So there are vector subspaces which cannot be topologically complemented in this way. You find more information on this in Appendix A. If there exists a topological complement to F sitting inside of E, we say F is a split subspace of E. Okay, and so this is again an infinite dimensional phenomenon. Some facts which you can learn about in a functional analysis course. If F is a finite dimensional subspace of E, then F is always split. Right, so finite dimensional subspace is always split in this way. Another word for split is, so which is also used is, one also says F is complemented. in the topological sense. Okay, and if S is a submanifold of M modeled on a complemented subspace F sitting inside of E, we say S is a split submanifold. Again, this is something which in finite dimensions, every submanifold you define in finite dimensions will always be a split submanifold, because all finite dimensional subspaces are split. In infinite dimensions, this is no longer true, so we have a special word for it. We say it's a split submanifold if the model space splits, or is a complemented subspace. Okay, now let's run through some other standard definitions, which we will be needing later on. So we have now submanifolds. There's also different ways we can construct new manifolds. So if M and N are CR manifolds, you can just take the Cartesian product of the two topological spaces and the Cartesian product of the two things. Probably I shouldn't write it like this. So make it clearer. So C for C being the set of charts phi times psi, where phi is from A, psi is from B, becomes a manifold, or CR manifold, called the direct product of the manifolds M and N. Okay, again, there should be not much U here. And now we come finally to why these manifolds are interesting, because we can look at differentiable mappings between these manifolds. So we start now with an investigation of differentiable mappings. So let's fix some order of differentiability. And let's say M and N are CR manifolds. Then F from M to N continuous. So we start with a continuous mapping. Is said to be a CR map. If, well, what you know, what you have probably seen in finite dimensions, for every pair of charts, phi u phi of M and psi psi of N, the map where we have psi composed with F composed with phi inverse. This is some map from phi of F inverse U psi intersected with U phi. This is some open subset in a locally convex space with values in another locally convex space, say F is a CR map. This is just the usual definition from finite dimensions. So we define the CR property in the way where we just say you test in charts, And whenever you can test, I mean, whenever we have a mapping defined on a non-trivial open subset of the model spaces, so the differentiability here again means Bastiani differentiability. Okay, and so let's rewrite CR from M to N for the set of all CR mappings from M to N. Okay. Well, and short remark. So it suffices to test the CR property with respect to any atlas of M and N. So if you've checked it in one atlas, then it will follow for all the other equivalent atlases by an insertion of charts argument. And what do I mean by this? Say you have checked that, say, for these charts, we get a CR mapping. If I find another chart in which I want to test it, so I can basically do the following. So say the other chart is kappa inverse. So I inserted the identity here. Let's say here we have lambda inverse. So insert the identity here, both with phi. So then we get psi, oops, inverses are wrong. So we have psi composed with kappa inverse, composed with kappa, composed with f, composed with lambda inverse, composed with lambda, composed with phi inverse. So this is what is usually called an insertion of charts argument. Basically, what this shows, if you know that the left-hand side is CR, then this already proves that at least on where on the joint domains, this guy here needs to be CR. Since we know that these change of charts we are looking here, these are CR mappings. Right, and so what this standard argument tells you, it suffices to test the CR properties in some charts. You don't need to do it for every for all the charts, which is often very convenient if you have a preferred set of charts in which you want to test it. Okay. Second thing which we see, if f and say from M to N is CR and G from N to L is CR, then the composition of both mappings is a CR map. Again, we can test this in charts if we want. And well, if M, N1, N2 are CR manifolds and F is given as F1, F2, F from M taking values in the direct product manifold. So this is CR if and only if F1 and F2 are CR mappings with the obvious notations. Right, and this morning we have seen the vector space version of this theorem, where we just went into a Cartesian product of vector spaces, and now we see here that what the claim is, the vector space version of this claim was lemma 1.2.11. And by inserting charts, we also see that this is true for the manifold. Okay. Now, let us show one more thing. So let M be a CR manifold and N inside of M be submanifold. Then the inclusion of sending N into M is CR map, and F from another CR manifold P to M or to N is CR map. Manifold if and only if. The composition with Yota is CR mapping. Okay. Right. And the proof, we're not doing the proof here, so this is very similar to the thing we have done on vector spaces. So test the property in charts and use lemma 1.2.12. So this was the statement. This was the statement that if we have a mapping into a subvector space which is sequentially closed, then this is of class CR if and only if it's a CR mapping into the larger space, right? And so this is so this 1.3.12 is just the manifold version of this lemma we proved this morning, and you prove it exactly by just applying the lemma to the mapping in charts, since we can test in charts. Okay. So this is a short review of things about differentiability and mappings between infinite dimension manifolds. We haven't seen so many manifolds yet, but this will change soon. Especially in the second chapter, we will construct certain infinite dimension manifolds. I think it's time for a little break. So.